Before I introduce today's guest, I wanted to tell you about our sponsor, which is the Great Courses Plus. This is what it looks like. It's an app on your phone right there. And this is the teaching company, the Great Courses, that I've been a fan of and consumer of for many years. And before, you had to go online and purchase a course and take the entire course, and that's all you got. Now, with the Great Courses Plus program, they have a subscription program. So if you subscribe, then you have access to hundreds of courses, thousands of courses, and therefore tens of thousands of lectures. If you get tired of a course, just switch to another course. I do it all the time. I'll hit two or three or half a dozen lectures in a particular subject. I get bored, or I just want to try something different, and I'll switch to a new one. So let's just see what pops up here, because they also are pretty current. So I hit that, and we get America's Long Struggle Against Slavery. Okay, it's pretty obvious why that's popped up now, as I'm recording this in the middle of the riots and looting and all that over the death of George Floyd. And so I touch on that, and then you get a list of the lectures to choose from: understanding the fight against slavery, the origins of slavery in the British Empire, the African slave trade, and so on and so forth, all the way down, slavery in the war for independence, the Haitian Revolution. It looks like there is 30 lectures ending in slavery by another name, probably slave labor, and fighting modern slavery. So I'm going to listen to a few of those. The deal is, if you go to their site, the Great Courses, greatcoursesplus.com/salon, you get a free trial, and as a listener of my podcast. So I recommend it. I consume their lectures all the time, along with audiobooks. So I recommend that you do that. Perfect time in this era of social isolation. So with that, thanks for the support from thegreatcoursesplus.com/salon.
Welcome to the Science Salon podcast. I'm your host, Michael Shermer. My guest this week is Walter Scheidel. His book is Escape from Rome: The Failure of Empire and the Road to Prosperity. It's a massive tome. I read maybe a quarter of it or so, and did my strategic skip reading around. It's a very technical, it's a scholarly work for professional historians, but it's also written for general audiences, which I like to bring you so that anybody could read the book. So we talk about the ancient world, why Rome instead of Greece, why Rome rose, how they consolidated, and then why they fell apart, and then the Middle Ages, the rise of the Roman Catholic Church, the role of Christianity in history, and then the early modern period into the economic takeoff and the explanations for the modern world and how we got here. I mean, we really cover just, you know, a couple thousand years in an hour. It's fantastic. He's really super interesting. He's very empirical and statistically based historian, and he uses the comparative method like Jared Diamond does. So I very much like that. Anyway, I hope you enjoy this conversation. He's just really a deep thinker. Big history, which I really like. And as always, if you appreciate the podcast, do support us if you can at skeptic.com/donate or at Patreon, where you can make a monthly donation. This is our primary source of support for the Skeptic Society is even small donations, $5 a month, $100 a year, whatever you can give, plus, of course, our memberships and subscriptions to the magazine, and at skeptic.com, our catalog of books and back issues of the magazine and so on. So thank you for listening to this. Thank you for supporting us.
Hey, you have our bottle of wine there, the Great Leveler.
I do indeed, yes.
And you drank it. That was from, that's from the salon we did. So this is actually your second time on the show, although the first salon was live. Your new book is Escape from Rome: The Failure of Empire and the Road to Prosperity. As readers can see, It's a massive tome, like your previous book. Before we get into the new book, though, let me ask you, the Great Leveler, since you wrote that book, the subject of income inequality has elevated even more in the national conversation, and Bernie's back on the presidential campaign, and calling, along with Elizabeth Warren, calling for, you know, redistribution and so on, this as if we're in a crisis. Give us your thoughts just on the state of income inequality. Why is this a bad thing? Is there really anything a politician could do if they were in office?
Well, I think so far what I wrote in my book has been borne out, that unless there are some major disasters, inequality is not going to go down. all by itself. That has certainly been corroborated by recent trends. Inequality remains high or keeps going up in the US. In particular, people talk more about it, so it's very much on the agenda. Whether any of the more radical measures that are now being proposed can be implemented politically, if there is enough will in the electorate, that remains to be seen. I remain skeptical. So we have to, you know, check back in a few years and see if things have really changed. But I very much doubt it.
Yeah, let me read you an excerpt from Steven Pinker's new book, The Enlightenment Now. Not really an excerpt. I quoted from it in an essay I wrote. Defending classical liberalism, but also noting that here's my quote, social spending to help those in need to survive and flourish, such as the homeless, mentally ill, physically handicapped, unemployed, and children with such necessities as shelter and housing, child care, food, energy, education, job training, and medical care, is something we should care about. I mean, we have a kind of a, don't we have a moral obligation, even those of us who are libertarian or classical liberal or even conservative. And then I quote Pinker, because I was quite surprised to read these statistics that he compiled, that the fact is today the strongest and fastest growing economies in the world allocate anywhere from 20 to 30% of their GDP to social expenditures, including in order France, 31.5%, Finland, 30%, Belgium, 29%, Italy, 28.9%, Denmark, 28.7%, Austria, 27.8%, Sweden, 27%, Germany, 25%, the UK, 21%, the US, 19.3%, Australia, 19.1%, and uber-liberal Canada bringing up the rear at 17.1%. So America, we're right up there with everybody else. Then how come everybody complains about us being this selfish, individualistic, greedy nation?
The differences are clearly small. Within high-income countries, the differences are fairly marginal. If you compare the U.S. with developing countries that commit a smaller share of GDP to welfare simply because there isn't enough money to go around, that would be a different story. But broadly speaking, the West or industrialized or high-income countries, they all run pretty expensive welfare systems. And the real question is, to what extent can you expand it further? If you live in Denmark or Sweden, there isn't all that much room for growth, right? In the U.S., arguably, there is some room for growth, some room for adjustment, but it's not going to make an enormous difference.
Right. Wow. I mean, it's almost like these huge trends that you track over centuries or millennia, they're almost like laws of nature that just sort of grind along, and all the politicians sort of chip away at it and try to nudge it this way or that way, and they really can't do much.
I think that's pretty much true. But, you know, well, maybe we'll be surprised. They're always outliers. We'll yeah. find out very soon, I guess.
That's right. Maybe in 2020. Or maybe not.
Maybe not.
Well, the new book. Wow. Okay. So Escape from Rome, The Failure of Empire in the Road to Prosperity. As I like to say, quoting Darwin, I call it Darwin's dictum, all observations must be for or against some view if they are to be of any service. So what's the view you are arguing against in this book?
The view I'm arguing against
or,
is...
Or for, or what, either.
No, I can't start with against. I mean, it's against the view which has been held for the last 1,500 years in some quarters, that the fall of the Roman Empire was a real disaster, was a real tragedy that created a huge hiatus in high culture for, you know, so-called Middle Ages, Dark Ages, Middle Ages, you name it. And my perspective is the exact opposite. My perspective is that it's actually the best thing that ever happened to us, and not just in Europe, but for the entire human species. Because the Roman Empire goes away and, more importantly, doesn't come back. It never comes back. Nothing like it ever returns to Europe. And it makes Europe over the last 1,500 years very different from other parts of the globe where conditions are in place that support the formation of empires. Very different from East Asia, South Asia, the Middle East, Mexico, Peru, you name it. In that, you have a very, very long period of multiple fragmentation, what I call competitive fragmentation of powers, both between states, because you always have a system of states. No one state is ever powerful enough to dominate all the others. And you have, arguably even more importantly, a lot of fragmentation within states, that there are different constituencies, people who wield economic or political or military or ideological power, vying for position, vying for status, for influence. No one group is ever powerful enough to, again, dominate all the others. And as a result, there's a lot of bargaining, of negotiation, and of compromise. And eventually you get a society that is very much built on this formalized bargaining and compromise. And again, that's something rather different from what you see in other parts of the globe.
Yeah. So I'm going to start with your last chapter, which is what have the Romans ever done for us? And I'm going to just play the little thing that you referenced from The Life of Brian from Monty Python, in which this little scene, which is quite hilarious. So here it is.
Take everything we had, but not just from us, from our fathers, and from our fathers' fathers.
And from our fathers' fathers' fathers.
Yeah.
And from our fathers' 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 fathers.
You're right, Stan, don't labor the point. And what have they ever given us in return? The aqueduct?
The aqueduct. Oh, yeah, they did give us that. That's true, yeah.
And the sanitation.
Oh, yeah, the sanitation, Reg. Remember what the city used to be like?
Yeah, all right, I'll grant you, the aqueduct and sanitation are two things the Romans have done.
And the roads.
Well, yeah, obviously the roads. I mean, the roads go without saying, don't they? But apart from the sanitation, the aqueduct and the roads...
Irrigation. Medicine. Education.
Yeah, all right, fair enough.
And the wine.
Yeah, that's something we really miss, Reg, if the Romans left.
Public baths.
And it's safe to walk in the streets at night now, Reg.
Yeah, they certainly know how to keep order. Let's face it, the only ones who could in a place like this. All right, but apart from the sanitation, the medicine, education, wine, public order, irrigation, roads, the fresh water system and public health, what have the Romans ever done for us?
Yep, so... Yeah. So, I mean, that it's funny because we think, yeah, those things are all true and those are good things, right?
They were certainly good things for people back then, definitely. And the punchline, of course, was peace, right?
Yes,
the whole
peace,
city
right.
is capped with peace. And that's really important, right? I mean, when has Europe ever had 500 years of peace, right? I mean, yeah. Never before and never again. So it was a real outlier in that respect.
Yeah. Yeah. So, but you're answering a different question, not what was life like 1500 years ago or 2000 years ago, and is that good or bad, but it, the effects of the Roman Empire on today. So your other big question is what explains the takeoff? That is the Industrial Revolution and, you know, this incredible world of wealth and prosperity, relatively speaking, that we have today. Could that have come about in Europe if the Roman Empire had not fallen?
That's the underlying idea. This transition to modernity happens only once. It's a unique event, and so we have to figure out what circumstances had to be in place to make that happen. And of course, I'm by no means the first person who think or write about this. There are shelf loads of books and tons of articles looking into this by historians, economists, political scientists, because it's one of the biggest questions in history, maybe the biggest question in history, right? Why has the world changed so much, and why did it happen where it did, mostly Northwestern Europe, when it did? You know, a couple hundred years ago. And there are essentially explanations. There are so many explanations. They are clustered in three different flavors. One flavor is to look at European domestic development, right? At institutions, political institutions, parliament, chartered cities, universities, rights, the kind of negotiations I talked about earlier that create spaces for merchants, for capitalists, for thinkers to pursue, you know, what they are doing without being too oppressed by traditional authorities. And that's arguably really important to build up a modern economy. The second feature is, well, it's a much nastier one. The Europeans, last 500 years, were really good at going out into the world, hitting other people over the head, exploiting them, colonizing them, enslaving them on an increasingly global scale. And that, of course, generates a lot of revenue of raw materials, creates markets for European products. So that's arguably an important part of the story. It's difficult to have the early English textile industry without slaves in the southern states making cotton, right? That's an important ingredient. Now, these things are maybe necessary, but they're not sufficient. Just exploiting other people is not going to create an economic takeoff, right? You need another ingredient, which is what is known as the culture of knowledge. You have to figure out ways of doing things differently in a way that really changes people's lives. To not just write, you know, lots of books about, I don't know, moral philosophy or whatever it is, but really try to understand the physical universe and not just understand it in an abstract way, but then harness your understanding to build a steam engine or use electricity or figure out what causes infectious disease, right? things that are invisible to the naked eye. You have to really take a step beyond what used to be done, out of your comfort zone, and find new ways of understanding the universe. And then if you put all these things together, the institutions, the global exploitation, the culture of knowledge, you have the right recipe for transformative change. So it's extremely rare for these things to come together in a specific way. That's not really surprising. It took that long. And it's not an accident, that's what I argue in the book, that it happened in Europe, because only in Europe do you get this kind of fragmentation that allows the competition, the openness to arise in ways that were necessary for this takeoff.
Yeah, David Deutsch calls that the beginning of infinity. He wrote this book in which basically he said that since the Enlightenment, the invention, the idea that what you just described, this sort of infinite knowledge of the physical world that you can manipulate to solve problems, it was kind of the launching off point of human progress, in as much that, you know, that the second law of thermodynamics dictates entropy rules the universe and things run down and there's more ways for things to go bad than good. So the whole point of life is to carve out a little niche of order by putting energy into the system in an organized fashion, using knowledge to solve problems. That kind of pushes off that launching point. So I don't know if you know his work, but he's a physicist, so it's sort of a different way of saying exactly what you just said. Why wouldn't that have happened had the Roman Empire continued?
Had the Roman Empire continued, or more likely, I mean, all empires fall apart. So it would have fallen apart at some point, but it should have been replaced by something similar, like what happens in China, right? You have 2,200 years of dynasties after, you know, dynasty after dynasty. You have similar serial reunifications in India and the Middle East and other parts of the globe, but not in Europe. Had that happened, you would have ended up with regimes that were more interested in preserving the status quo, where you have an entrenched elite on top that upholds certain traditions, be it aristocratic values or certain religious doctrines like Islam or Confucianism or what have you. And that's just not that conducive to genuine transformative change. They can deliver public goods, they preserve peace, they do all the things that the Monty Pythons listed, which people would benefit from for some time, and there would be some improvements, you know, at the margins, but there wouldn't be anything that was genuinely transformative. People have looked at China in particular for a long time because there's just so much evidence. There was so much science there, so much learning, so many inventions, gunpowder, the floating compass, all kinds of really important things. And the question is, why didn't China have an industrial revolution many hundreds of years earlier? Because on paper, conditions are pretty good. Large empire, unified markets, peace, stability, capital, all kinds of things are in place. But it seems that's not the right kind of dynamic. The right kind of dynamic is one where you have a lot of competition, and a competition that's coupled with formalized negotiation, bargaining, compromise, dialogue between the rulers and the ruled, not, you know, behind closed doors, but out in the open. And that really creates conditions that are just, you know, more favorable to a particular kind of development like we see in Northwestern Europe in particular, in the Netherlands, in Britain, over the last few hundred years.
Are there geographic differences between China and, say, Europe or England?
There are massive geographic differences. Again, this has been observed for hundreds of years. It has sort of fallen out of favor because whenever, as a historian, you know, talk about geography, you immediately brand it as a geographical determinist.
Yeah.
Nobody, I hope, no sane person would claim that geography determines history, but you also can't claim it's irrelevant. It certainly shapes social evolution over the long term. And here you can see Europe is really different. Europe doesn't have the big floodplains like the Yellow River Valley, the Ganges Valley, Nile Valley, that is like a natural core, a natural center for the building up of large states. It's very fragmented. You have the Alps and the Carpathians and the Pyrenees carving up the landscape. You have a lot of peninsulas, Italy, Iberia, Scandinavia. You have big islands like England. And arguably most importantly, it is sheltered from the inner Asian steppe. And if you look at global history, the history of the old world over the last 2,500 years, you see that interaction with the steppe people, the herders, the nomads, the semi-nomadic groups, ranging from what is now Ukraine all the way to the Pacific, that's a really important driver of large-scale state formation. Often empires become bigger because they have to face threats from the steppe, and then empires form in the steppe. Or steppe people move in, like the Mongols in China, or the Mughals in India, or any number of groups, or people, Turkic groups taking over the Middle East, setting up these large predatory empires where you have a small ruling class of different ethnic origin, and everybody else is an imperial subject. And that pushes society in the opposite direction. That's the exact opposite of what you see in Europe. So all these things, again, interact in pretty complex, but I think visible ways to make Europe significantly different from the rest of the world. And when I say Europe, it's Europe west of Russia, right? Russia is the real life counterfactual. Russia is a product of engagement with people in the steppe. That's why Moscow had to become so big to push them back and then establish the biggest land empire in history. And in so doing, shielded Europe even further, right? Now people in Western Europe are protected from these incursions.
So, and wasn't there something about how mountainous an area is because the mountain ranges split off communities and they have a little more freedom to be isolated and do different social experiments and then economic experiments without a strong hand coming in on a flatter ground that can more easily get to them and squelch their creativity of economics and politics?
That seems to be the case. If you look at Chinese history, China's for a long term dominated by the Central Plain region, south of Beijing, between Beijing and Shanghai. Now, broadly speaking, where for the most time, most of the people in China live, it's a huge floodplain. If you control that area, you have an enormous concentration of people and power, of resources at your disposal, which you can use to build and maintain a large empire. There's nothing like this in Europe, and with premodern technology, it's pretty difficult to project power, say, across the Alps or across the various peninsulas and so on. So that's a natural constraint on large empire building, which actually leads to an interesting observation, I think, which is one that's not usually made. Why was there a Roman Empire to begin with, right? I mean, if Europe is actually suitable for this kind of state building, the real question is not, why did the Roman Empire fall? I find it's a kind of a boring question, because most empires in history fell at some point. The real questions were, why doesn't it come back? And I've tried to answer this. And then the question becomes, well, why was there an empire to begin with? And it was a bit of a historical aberration and anomaly not to be repeated later on.
Yeah. So before you walk us through how the empire got built, I just want to make a comment about your methodology that I like very much. It's very data-driven. Use the comparative method that Jared Diamond uses, like in Guns, Germs, and Steel and his other books. You know, like I always liked about Jared, you know, it's like historians go, you know, A happened, then B happened, then C happened, then D happened. And at some point, Jared goes, okay, let's look at another place in the world where it didn't happen in that sequence. C happened, then B, then D, then A, and look at the outcomes. So he called this comparative method. And I think that's something like what you do here when you're comparing, say, Rome to China and the different outcomes. So that's is that a self-conscious methodology you employ?
That is very self-conscious. I think it's impossible to say anything meaningful about any one place without looking at other places at the same time. And that's just not done enough in history because it's understandable, right? You want to be a specialist. You want to get everything right about your area of specialization. So there's a trade-off. There are risks in branching out. And we are not a collaborative discipline. If you had a team of people, it would be much easier to organize. For one person, there are hazards. I'm sure there are some details in my book that are not, you know, quite up to current standards in the study of, I don't know, ancient India. But it's a price we have to pay. And I think the trade-off is it really helps us understand causation, causal, important key causal relationships in long-term our social development.
You have a lot of data and graphs in the book charting, say, population growth or decline or estimated per capita GDP or what. How do you know? Where do you get this data from for those societies? Do they have censuses that they took and that sort of thing? And are they accurate?
Well, the short answer is it has to be good enough. You have to have data that even if they're 10 or 20 or 30% off, it wouldn't make a big difference to your argument. So you have to be very careful how you use these data. They are estimates, sometimes guesstimates, right? They're extrapolations from bits and pieces that we do know. Because there are census data, there are census data in China going back 2,000 years. We have some idea how many people there were in the Roman Empire or late in European history. So that's good enough for what I'm trying to do. If you try to do more complex investigations, it might not be good enough. But it's good enough to support the argument. And again, historians are often wary of the very idea of good enough, because it may just not be good enough, right? And so there's always this drive towards perfection and knowing more and more about more details. And I'm really consciously, deliberately taking three steps back, asking, how much do I need to know in order to support my argument? How wrong would I have to be for my argument to be wrong? And that's my standard. And if I meet that standard, that's good enough for me.
Okay. And the reason you care about population growth is because in order to have an empire, you need a certain amount of people for division of labor, taxation to support the state and that sort of thing.
That's certainly true. And I look at population in particular because there are empires that are very large on a map, right? You look at the Mongol Empire, but it's a lot of empty space in Central Asia. And there are other empires that are relatively small, like certain periods of Chinese history, but there are enormous numbers of people contained within a single polity. And so what I do in the book is I measure for big chunks of the world, Europe, Middle East, South Asia, East Asia, what percentage of the total population of these regions was at any one point ruled by the biggest empire in that part of the world. And that's really what supports the argument, because it shows us a huge discontinuity between the Roman period. There's something like 80% of all people in Europe lived under Roman rule, and later on, where no more than 20% of Europeans would be part of the largest state, France, Russia. Later on, well, in China, it's regularly 80 or 90% of all people in East Asia who are ruled by some Chinese emperor. And you have similarly powerful entities in India or in the Middle East. So I use demographic data to establish this difference, this contrast, beyond any reasonable doubt. And nobody has really done this before in quite the same way.
Interesting. So percentage of people under the reign of the empire in a particular area. And would the distance from the center, power center of the empire matter?
I'm not sure it matters all that much. I mean, the logistical constraints on how big a land empire can become. And if it becomes too big, it will fall apart. Like the Mongol Empire fractures into four different parts quite rapidly because it's just too elongated. It's not sustainable. That's a problem really for empires. It's not a problem so much for Europeans because their states tend to be much smaller and therefore also more integrated, which is ultimately a good thing, because if you want to build up a more sort of advanced kind of society with more meaningful interaction between different classes, rulers and ruled, it helps if your country is not enormously large, especially with premodern technology.
Yeah, my wife, you met Jennifer. She's from Cologne, Germany, and so I've gotten to know that city pretty well. There are a lot of Roman ruins in Cologne. In fact, every other construction project gets halted because they run into some, what it turns out to be an archaeological site of ancient Rome. How did they monitor? That's a long ways away from Rome, city of Rome, you know, northwestern Germany. How did they access that those areas and send people there and tax collectors or whatever?
Well, Cologne is already a bit of a stretch because you have to cross the Alps from Italy to get to Cologne. It helps us on the River Rhine, so there are lines of communication at the local level, although, of course, the Rhine is not connected to the Mediterranean, so you have to brave the Alps. You have to build roads, which the Romans do with great effort. Romans are really lucky because their empire, its center is not really some great plain. It's the Mediterranean Sea, and it's much cheaper and much faster to traverse the sea, especially a benign sea like the Mediterranean, where you don't have major storms like in other parts of the world. And that's the real center of the empire. And it allows the Roman Empire to become much bigger than it could have been had it been a pure land empire. Mm. It's almost like an early maritime empire in that it relies critically on these maritime connections in the inner core, and then it projects power outwards into northwestern Europe, into the Middle East, into Egypt, all these different parts, but only up to a point. And that's exactly where the Roman advance comes to a standstill. They get to the Rhine, but they couldn't get into Germany or Poland or Scandinavia. It seems to be just too far away. The logistical constraints are too powerful in that case.
Yeah. Maybe a little bit like the much later British Empire, mainly a seafaring empire that they controlled that way. So why did this not happen with, say, ancient Greece?
Ancient Greece consists of about 1,000 city-states. That's a pretty inauspicious beginning. There are attempts. The Athenians tried to build up an empire in the 5th century BC in the Aegean, but it falls apart very soon. Turns out the Romans are quite successful at co-opting other people at low cost. Because when they start out, Rome is a small town on the River Tiber in the middle of Italy. there are hundreds of city-states, tribes, polities, chiefdoms, whatever you want to call them, all over Italy. That's a huge challenge to bring all these people together. And the Romans figure out how to do this, not by formally conquering people, not by taxing them, by taking away their money or their livestock. They tax them very lightly and in a very honorable way by saying, well, we can all be allies, and your young man can join our young men, and we go out and we fight other young men, and we defeat them, and then we kill and enslave some of them and incorporate the others. And then we have a bigger army, and our bigger army next year is going to go out and do the same thing all over again. And Roman history is essentially hundreds of years of scaling up from very small beginnings, drawing people in all over Italy, till in the end you have a few million people under Roman control in Italy. Everybody who is 17 years old, has two arms and two legs, is liable to serve in the military at essentially just at cost, right? They don't get paid much, they get fed, they may have to provide their own equipment, and they're very victorious in the long run because there's so many of them. You can lose battles. Romans basically never lose a single war for hundreds of years. There are no other societies out in Western Eurasia that are organized in a similar way. So it's an asymmetric kind of conflict. You have the established kingdoms in the Hellenistic East, in Egypt, in Asia Minor, in Syria, which are more traditional kingdoms. They have armies of mercenaries, which are very good, but they're also very expensive, and they're not as numerous. And if you beat them in battle, they're hard to replace. So these kingdoms can be easily overcome and conquered. And then in Europe itself, in Spain, in France, in the Alps, in the Balkans, in North Africa, there are lots of small-scale societies, what used to be called tribes, whatever you want to call them. They're very warlike, so that's a problem, but they can't scale up. They find it very difficult to form large, durable alliances. So the Romans can pick them off one by one, turn them against each other, grind them down. Can take hundreds of years, but eventually the Romans are the only people left standing. And they control that part of the world. They reach the Atlantic, the Sahara, then sparsely populated parts of the interior of Europe. So they almost push against natural boundaries. And once you do that, you can survive as an empire for hundreds of years without making too much of an effort.
Just by momentum.
By momentum and then status quo, right? And then you switch to preserving the status quo, which is what all very large empires do. Because once you rule 50 or 100 million people, you're not worried about conquering more people. Your biggest worry is how to hold on to the people you already have and tax them, exploit them accordingly to maintain your power structures.
And just having a common language and currency probably helps.
That certainly helps. You have a lot of economic activity, exchange, within the Roman Empire, but it's really the kind of what economists call Smithian growth, where you have more division of labor, more and better trade, institutions that protect trade and commerce, and it allows you to maximize existing forms of economic production, right? You sort of improve what's already there, but you don't really take the next step. You don't get to Schumpeterian competition, creative destruction, where you say, well, instead of having, you know, the pin factory where you have division of labor and one guy makes just the head of the pin and so on, you say, well, might not have machines that make pins, or get rid of pins altogether and we do things without pins. And that's really a hallmark of modernity, to do things in a dramatically different way. Something you don't find in Rome, in China, in any other pre-modern economic system. And I think that's, again, tied up with the kind of conservatism, preservation of the status quo that's logically inherent in large-scale imperial rule. It doesn't matter what ethnicity people are, what the underlying culture is. That's just an imperative of running a large traditional empire.
Right. And, well, plus, of course, they didn't have the specified knowledge for creating, say, a steam engine or a factory in which you have a division of labor like that to make pins or whatever, driven by a steam engine. They just didn't have the knowledge for that, even if
they also don't have the incentive, right? Because building a steam engine is really hard if you do it for the first time. It took like 100 years to come up with steam engines that were halfway efficient and actually worked properly. And if you don't have a very strong incentive for doing that, well, why would you? And that's where the competitive fragmentation comes in. When this happens in Europe or elsewhere, there are strong protectionist barriers in place between European countries. You have mercantilism. You didn't want to trade with other countries or only to your own advantage. There was a lot of isolationism, as we would now call it. And that distorts markets in interesting ways and forces people in individual countries to think about new ways of, you know, getting ahead, making things they can't easily import from somewhere else. And that's the environment in which machine production takes off, and investment, because you also need people paying for this stuff. You need to have capitalists who are willing to experiment and take risks and go behind new ventures. And it comes together, again, only in a few places in the world a few hundred years ago.
Right. So the Romans weren't trading. They didn't have a free trade system with other countries. They were just assimilating them, ultimately, through their whatever invasion techniques.
Yes. I mean, then when they are the imperial subjects, they trade freely within the empire.
Within the empire, yeah. Yes.
But then there are also no incentives to do things a better way, because you already have a huge market. Like China always had a huge internal market. Mm. If you are Portugal in the 15th century, there are a million people in Portugal, you're at the very margins of Europe, your incentive structure is going to be very different. The only way you can go ahead, get ahead, is you build ships, you sail down the African coast, you try to cross the Atlantic, you do all kinds of crazy things, right, that you wouldn't ordinarily do. They're costly, they're uncertain, they're risky, they're anomalous. And yet, there is huge payoff, right, in this particular case. And that's something that other empires lack. You find, interestingly, across history, it's not the big empires that have huge reserves of capital that promote, say, exploration or overseas trade. It's the small entities. It's the Greeks, the Phoenicians, the Portuguese, the Dutch, the English, the Vikings, you know, the Polynesians way back when they colonized the Pacific. It's always small marginal groups, the people in Oman, in the Indian Ocean. They are the ones who go out and do these interesting and risky things. It's never the big empires. They are far too focused on what they already have, controlling their large populations.
Yeah, I think it's a good perspective to keep in mind in terms of modern debates about, who becomes the most powerful and controlling, like Elizabeth Warren wants to break up the big tech companies or whatever. Or we should tax the super wealthy. One thing people are forgetting is all the failures, all the people that attempted to build the equivalent of a Google or an Apple or an Amazon, and they failed. And we don't even know who they are. And my venture capitalist friends tell me that, you know, they only fund maybe 10 out of 100 pitches they hear, and maybe only one out of those 10 end up making them money. What happened to the other 99? They all failed. And that's the normal part.
Well, I think that's a good point, because you can actually generalize from this. If you have parts of the world where you have a monopolistic power, there's really only one way of doing things. If in Europe you have 20 different countries, some are Catholic, some are Protestant, some are maritime, some are inland, some are this, some are that, some are monarchies, some are republics, you have a great deal of diversity, and they will all try to do things differently. And many of them will fail, right? There will be dead ends. There will be just business as usual or worse. But the chance that one or two of them figure out new things that actually work much better is infinitely bigger than in a system where you have a single monopolist. That's just, you know, common sense. And that's something that doesn't happen all that often in world history.
Right. So that's the thesis of your book, is that the Roman Empire was kind of, in a way, squelching that sort of diversity of experimentation.
And not actively, just by existing.
Just by existing.
Providing an environment where there was no strong motivation for trying, for doing things differently.
What's the height? When was the height of the Roman Empire, and when did it start to fall apart?
Well, you could probably say a second century. Gibbon said, you know, that was the happiest time of mankind.
Yeah.
In the middle of the second century AD, you have peace, stability, 60, 70 million people, unified currency. They were still winning all their wars. And then things start falling apart. And they start falling apart for pretty much the same reasons other empires fell apart too. Because if you have a big empire and it lasts a really long time, you're going to get certain internal dynamics. You get elites who become richer and richer, you have more and more inequality. They don't really want to pay taxes. They withhold resources from the center. So there's more and more competition in elite circles for the available surplus. And the people right beyond the borders, because empires had to stop expanding at some point, for logistical or geographical, ecological reasons, the people right beyond, they get their act together. They absorb information, know-how from the empire. They build up their own capabilities. They get better at organizing their societies, at fighting, organizing people, and so on, and can put more and more pressure on the empire. It can be the Germans. It can be the Arabs in the age of Muhammad. It can be people out in the steppe in the case of China. This happens time and again. And it's almost inevitable, right, for large empires to experience these problems. And then these problems all come together in a certain way. You enter a kind of death spiral. You can no longer collect enough resources to defend the empire. And then people say, why should we pay taxes if the authorities can't defend us? And then newcomers infiltrate or invade and then say, we can do the same thing, but at lower cost. And then people defect. And all of a sudden, the imperial structure unravels and is reconfigured. And that's what happens in Western Europe in the 5th century AD when the Germans come in and take over Italy, Spain, France, parts of North Africa, and Britain.
The Huns, right?
Well, the Huns are sort of the people behind it, people who come out of the inner Asian steppe, and they, in a sense, push. I mean, that's a bit simplistic, but they put pressure on Germanic groups in Germany, in Poland, in Central Europe, you would say now. And they now have an even bigger incentive to want to enter the Roman Empire and take over land and resources.
So peak around 2nd century CE and then demise by the end of the 5th century middle of the, And then, so there's 1,000 years, say, between 500 and 1500. What was going on there?
In terms of, well, international relations, arguably not all that much, because the successor states are pretty weak. They have far fewer capabilities than the Roman Empire used to have. They are they're far less centralized. There are kings, but powerful nobilities that own much of the land. You have knights in their castles who wield military power. It's very difficult to tell them to do stuff they don't want to do. You may have to bribe them or cajole them or somehow persuade them to follow you. You have the church that becomes more and more powerful in the Middle Ages. The papacy experiences this huge rise in the middle and high and late Middle Ages. There's conflict between church and state. You have independent city-states with lots of rich merchants who oppose feudal lords. So you have all these fractures all across European society. And as a result of this, states are often more preoccupied with internal conflict and bargaining than with fighting other states, because they are just not in good enough shape to stage major wars. And that's why some of these wars take a long time. The Hundred Years' War, when England tries to take over France, takes 100 years because, you know, it's just really difficult to do with the resources available at the time. So it's a period where Europe is sheltered from the outside world. The Arabs fail to take over Europe in the 7th and 8th centuries because they themselves are fractured because of tribal differences and all kinds of fault lines in the conquered society. The Mongols turn around, they go somewhere else, they're not very interested in Europe because it's hard for their horses to enter Europe. They're not enough, there's not enough grassland. But the Europeans for about 1,000 years are left to their own devices to sort things out amongst themselves, politically, economically, and in terms of social institutions. And so you end up with these states that get strong over time. There is a process of governments reasserting power very slowly, but they do so not by getting rid of all this information, innovation. They build on it. They build on things like parliaments or chartered cities or universities and rights having been granted to certain groups. They can't be totally despotic as some conquest regime could be somewhere else in the world. They just sweep in, conquer everybody, kill the old ruling class, take over, live in a fortified compound like the Mughals did or the Manchus in China, and then try to project power for a while, and then they fail. European governments have to operate in a very, very different way. They have to actually engage with at least important parts of their own population, civic society, as we would now say. And the resultant states are much more integrated and eventually become much more capable. And that's when you enter phase two, which is the early modern period, 16th, 17th century, 18th century, you open any history book, the whole period from 1500 to 1800, endless war, one war after the other, overlapping wars, but no one state is powerful enough to beat and conquer all the others. Habsburg discovered this, Louis XIV discovered this, Napoleon discovered this, because whenever one power becomes too strong, all the others will form alliances, they will balance, they will contain this expansion, and a single empire simply can't form under these circumstances. Napoleon tries really hard, he comes the closest, but he has to take on England, he has to take on Russia to really dominate all of Europe, and it's just not possible. And it wasn't possible for Hitler either 100 plus years later for essentially the same reasons.
Yeah, I was when I was writing the chapter on war and the moral arc, I sat in on a a course on the history of war in which the professor was pretty tuned into economic differences between the great powers throughout the modern period and noted, for example, that the moment the United States entered the Second World War, it was over for Germany, just economically. There's just no way they could compete with the industrial might. We could crank out, I don't know, 1,000 airplanes a week or whatever it was, and eventually they would lose just almost inevitably.
Yeah, that's certainly the case. But it's just the latest round of, you know, attempting to build an empire. And all the earlier rounds, you know, were similar failures.
So when you mentioned the Catholic Church, I was thinking, you know, the Roman Catholic Church. So it made me think of, you know, did it act in a way like Rome did in suppressing the kind of diversity of thought you need to have the takeoff?
Probably for the first 1,000 years, because the Catholic Church pretty much has a monopoly in over Europe in terms of being a dominant belief system. And the papacy becomes stronger at the same time, so you have more centralization of the Christian church. But then, of course, you get the Reformation. The Reformation adds another ingredient to European fragmentation. All of a sudden, you have fault lines between countries, within countries, more fractures, more competition, 30 years war, all kinds of horrible things happening as a result of this. But when the dust settles, you have Protestant societies on the one hand, Netherlands, Northern Germany, Northern France, some extent Britain, Scandinavia, and then the Catholic ones farther south. And it turns out it's the Protestant ones that do better over the next couple of centuries. And you could argue it's by pushing back certain established doctrines, certain ways of doing things, the hegemony of the papacy, of the church, that again has a liberating effect, for want of a different word. It's easier to question archaic doctrine, try to do things differently, and that's always the way forward.
Do better economically, you mean?
As well, yes. Certainly, there's also a strong connection between being a Protestant and being able to read, right? Because the Protestants promote reading the Bible. And once you can read the Bible, you can read other stuff too. And you see huge, in as much as you can estimate literacy rates in early modern Europe, there begin to be huge differences between places like the Netherlands and Britain on the one hand, or Italy or Spain on the other. And that's to a large extent driven by religious beliefs, that people are ordinary people are encouraged to learn to read and write. In other places, they may be actively discouraged.
As Christopher Hitchens said, religion poisons everything, but not all religions. Some are better than others. Protestantism is better. Well, because that, again, back to the, you know, it's just you and God, and you can read the Bible yourself, and we're going to print it in a vernacular language that anybody can read rather than Latin. So on.
That's right, and the individual matters. Yeah, and you elect your pastors and so on. So all these things that used to be common in the Catholic Church had been suppressed, actually come back with Protestantism.
Now, how did the Catholic Church maintain, when it was in its height of power, say, I don't know, 1,000 to 1,400 or so, just by sending monks out, like missionaries are almost like Roman legions going out to sort of maintain control over the people and what they're reading and thinking?
Well, you have monks, but then you have to control all the different monasteries because they're fairly autonomous. They have their own land and their own abbots and do their own thing. What the papacy does is it operates by sending out emissaries who, you know, check on what the bishops and the abbots are doing, and by organizing councils, right, by bringing all the upper tier of the church together periodically in Rome or in Italy and other places, and basically telling them what to do. I mean, creating consensus, letting people debate, but under papal guidance, and then whatever they decide is binding for everyone all over Europe. And of course, that creates problems. That's where you have the so-called heresies, people who want to do things differently. But as long as these councils represent the vast majority of the Christian leadership, well, they're in a pretty strong position to do things a certain way that has been approved by the Vatican. And it's only with the Protestant split that the first real challenge arises. Earlier heresies are suppressed, often very violently, but there are just so many Protestants, and it takes off so rapidly in large parts of Europe, it cannot be contained. And then you have a fracture that can no longer be bridged.
Interesting. So let's then shift now 1500 to say 1800 or 1900. So you do get some consolidation of these smaller city-states or political units, whatever they're called. I think the estimate was like there's 5,000 different political units in
500, but it depends.
500, yeah.
Count,
yeah. I don't know how you count them. And then, you know, by say 1900, there's, you know, far less than that.
1,000, yeah. fewer than now, actually.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. There's been more, you know, a little bit of less consolidation. Well, we'll never reach a one world government, obviously. It hit the floor there on the decline of the number of political units. You need some. But in your formula, what's the right balance of, you know, having enough consolidated power that you can have a stable economy and a banking system and reliable capital and so on, educational systems and so on, to be able to have an industrial revolution?
Yep. It seems to be some kind of Goldilocks scenario that's hard to, you know, replicate. Where England, for instance, was a highly centralized state in some ways. It had the highest tax rates in Europe to pay for the Navy, which was really expensive. Parliament helps integrate the country because people are being represented in a central place and they have real input into the political process. So by many standards, it's an unusually centralized and integrated state. But at the same time, you have guaranteed rights for all kinds of different groups, not just in terms of religious beliefs, but property rights, right? Protecting capitalists, merchants, protecting investments, patent rights, right? You can actually patent ideas, which is obvious to us, but wasn't obvious at the time. And under those conditions, you can have a functioning stock market, a bond market, public debt, more sophisticated financial institutions, all kinds of things that provide an infrastructure for modern enterprise to take off, because it can fund, support, promote industrialization, overseas trade, all the things that are essential for the first and especially the second industrial revolution, where you then have electrification and advances in chemistry and enormous advances scientifically in all different domains. But it's really underpinned by the political and economic infrastructure.
Yeah, I mean, when we think of the word capitalism, that word capital, I mean, most wealth was generated through labor until the modern world. And so, you know, Marx's theory of labor, let me rephrase that. The incentive is for people to take a risk in trying new things, but you got to have capital. So you need some kind of banking system or wealthy people that can become what we would call venture capitalists, somebody to put up the money to take the risk. And then you have to pay for that money. You know, so when modern, say, Elizabeth Warren type socialist Democrats feel like, well, why should the CEO make 100 times more than the average worker, or 300 times more, or whatever? At some point, it sort of feels like it's an unfair balance, but we don't see what's behind the economic structure to provide the capital to produce those things in the first place. Walk us through how that kind of came about. Did states consciously say, we need to reward, like through the patent system, new ideas, but we also need to allow people to make a lot of money because they're taking the risk. And then the people that take the risk and fail, well, that's just the way it goes.
Well, the early system is not a pretty picture because, again, it's driven by competition between states. So the patent system is to say, well, we want people in England or in France, right, who make inventions to stay there and, you know, develop their things there, not go somewhere else, and they will be protected accordingly. There's always a great deal of collusion, we would now say, between government and certain elite groups. And the elite groups have the ear of the government, like the people who build, you know, the early textile mills or promote the coal industry or the slave trade, for that matter, for a long time, right? I mean, they are very nasty types of economic activity. They have the ear of the government, and the government actively protects them. It's crony capitalism.
Yes, totally.
But it has almost perversely the result of allowing beneficial or productive transitions to happen that would otherwise have been much more difficult to engineer. And of course, you also have to have some kind of bankruptcy law, right? I mean, if the risk takers, if they fail, they are thrown into jail for not being successful. Yeah. That wouldn't work either.
Right.
And so you have to have a system that to some extent benefits the successful ones and maybe benefits them disproportionately, right? That's part of the price you have to pay, arguably, at least at that stage of development, to get development going in the first place. It can't be over-socialized because it wouldn't really happen.
Yeah, people miss that Adam Smith was actually pretty critical of a lot of businessmen. There's that famous phrase from The Wealth of Nations where rarely do businessmen get together before they're colluding against other groups and trying to, well, we call rent seeking, you know, going to the government and say, we want you to protect our industry against those guys over there. What's wrong with them? They're competing with us. That's it.
A But the classic example is, I mean, the English had to have their own local textile industry. It would have been much easier and cheaper to import Finnish textiles from India, where people churned them out in huge quantities at much lower cost. Wages are high in England, they're low in India.
Yeah.
The obvious, you know, neoliberal thing would be to just have free trade. But it didn't have free trade. Protectionism, colonialism, and so on. There are these artificial barriers that force people onto weird trajectories, like saying, well, I can't hire enough workers for this because it's too expensive. I can build a machine, which, you know, no sane person would otherwise think of doing because it's really difficult and it takes a lot of time. So you have these strange, you need to have these strange distortions in place that are a product of often irrational competition among states. We must beat the French, we must beat the Spanish, and therefore we can't import stuff from India, but we have to have our own factories. And so that's a very strange kind of environment, but it does yield breakthroughs that would not otherwise have happened.
Yeah, there was an article in the paper this morning about whiskey distillers in Scotland shipping whiskey to America by jet, by plane, to beat the tariff that starts tonight. Because if they shipped it by boat, which is way cheaper, it would be a 25% tariff. It's like, this is exactly what Adam Smith was writing against. This is mercantilism.
Right.
We're still doing it. But at some point, you know, there was pushback against that after Adam Smith's book actually kind of laid out why this was not good for a nation. But there's still kind of a sense of economic nationalism. I don't know if it's a psychological thing. We feel like, you know, the job should be in America. Why? I don't care where my iPad is made. I just want it relatively cheap. But, you know, okay, setting aside the slave labor conditions of that company that Apple uses in China, whatever, you know, what's wrong with my goods being made elsewhere? So it seems like that nationalism is still kind of that economic tribalism of some kind is still there in our psychology.
And that's not surprising, because in my book I talk about the benefits of having fragmentation, a state system, competition, even wars for many hundreds of years. There is a downside. It's not just that wars cost lots of lives and cause suffering. It is also that it creates the kind of nationalism that is still with us. If you have states that are deeply steeped in a culture of nationalism, glorifying the nation state to varying degrees, as Europeans have done for a long time and the US has done in many ways, and other countries have almost learned to do in a way by imitating this European template, you end up with a setup that is not terribly productive if the world changes, right? It can be beneficial while all states compete. It's no longer beneficial if you say you face global climate change, right? Or some other problems where you need more cooperation and more across-border contacts and lack of conflict rather than more. And the more you subscribe to the model of the nation state, the more your political discourse is suffused with nationalism, the less able you will be to address those global problems. So you could say, in a way, nationalism contributes to the rise of modernity. It creates all these things that made us rich and healthy and better educated and freer and so on. And now all of a sudden we realize there's a price to be paid. And in dealing with these problems, we may have to be less, you know, fragmented and nationalistic and think more and operate more on a global scale. We may not be that well prepared for that because we have evolved politically in a certain direction. And now the world might need something different, and it's difficult to get from A to B in the time that we have.
Yeah, you see that play out in modern debates like over Brexit. You know, why should someone in Brussels tell us in England what we can charge for eggs? You know, that's kind of their plaint. Or immigration, you know, Angela Merkel opens the borders up because, you know, Germany has a pretty bad history of treating foreigners in a pretty nasty way. So they want to do the right thing and have a moral obligation to help these Syrian refugees. But they don't really have the same German national cultural background or goals or whatever. There's this kind of debate or discussion of, is there a national type or personality or culture that you inculcate as an American or a British or French or German or whatever? The Germans work hard and the French drink wine and whatever. I mean, to what extent, you know, is some of that at least true in terms of culture?
I mean, if depending on where the refugees come from, that's certainly an issue. I think the problem is that there is a hope or a desire at the level of, say, European elites, people in Brussels or elites that form national, you know, governments or ruling classes, so to speak, that you can somehow shed all the legacies of nationalism more or less overnight and become this more globalized, open society. And it may work at the elite level because elites are just more cosmopolitan and more interconnected and more mobile, and they are happy to go to Brussels and do their thing. But it may not work quite as well for the majority of these societies. And in as much as they are democracies, that, of course, creates political pushback, all kinds of problems that we could not have anticipated just a couple decades ago, rise of populism, rise of far-right parties all across the board in Germany, in France, in Italy, in a number of places. If anybody had predicted this 20 years ago, it would have been very surprised, right? So there is a significant trade-off that's rooted in the strength of these nationalistic legacies that, well, contributed a lot to our current well-being. So they are difficult to get rid of. And the open question is, should we want them to be eroded and go away, or should they be maintained in a certain way? And that, of course, then runs up in creates problems with the kind of immigration that you talked about.
Yeah, one of the explanations for the Trump phenomenon is these working class, lower middle class, middle America whites did not benefit from globalism and international trade and all these wonderful things that elites talk about. In fact, their incomes went down or they lost their jobs completely. And, you know, here comes a guy that says, I'm going to fix that. We're tired of losing. We're going to start winning and we're going to stick it to China and everybody else on our trade agreements and so on. And that's pretty much what he's done.
That's only, you always have trade-offs. In every period, you have trade-offs. Whatever beneficial development there is, industrialization, globalization, there will be a trade-off in the form of conflict, protectionism, populism. Now, it seems to be very difficult to have just positive outcome, so to speak, without any kind of drawbacks. That's not really surprising. But I think our job is to identify the trade-offs in different periods, see how they compare, weigh their relative significance, and, you know, let that inform our policymaking as well, our strategies for the future.
Is there an analog historically to what we're going through now with that, that we could learn from?
I think what has happened over the last couple hundred years has changed the world so much that we can arguably learn less and less directly from history. The way people very reasonably thought you could learn from history, because not that much would change, right, from one period to the next. I think we are now genuinely in a different kind of boat, especially with the kind of global challenges we face that are unprecedented, either in nature or in scale. In nature, in terms of the aging of populations in rich countries that will spread around the world, destabilize welfare systems and so on. And in terms of scale, there were environmental crises before, but they weren't necessarily global, not since the last ice age. It was a really long time ago. Now they are, and again, we're all in the same boat. It will affect different parts of the world differently, but we are not well prepared in terms of our historical inheritance, so to speak, to deal with these problems because they are so novel in some way.
Yeah. You talk in the book about counterfactuals, which I love doing. You know, if the South had won the war at Gettysburg because of this little thing that happened, you know, those are kind of fun, almost science fiction-y type experiments. But in a way, it's a way of thinking about causality. And so had there never been a Roman Empire, or had the Roman Catholic Church not dominated for 1,000 years, would we have colonized Mars 1,000 years ago and so on and have these futuristic worlds we're thinking about now?
I write about this at the end of my book, and yeah. I'm inclined to think that if there had never been a Roman Empire, you know, the world in the early Middle Ages without the Roman Empire need not have been that much different from the real world after the Roman Empire. You could draw a straight line from all these small states and city-states and tribes and chiefdoms before Rome came along, all the way up to medieval societies. You could have gotten to that point without the Roman interlude. The one thing you probably wouldn't have had was Christianity, because Christianity is a direct product of the Roman state. The fact that it became so powerful so rapidly owes a lot to sponsorship eventually by the Roman government. And then the question becomes not, did the Romans make a difference? The question is, did Christianity make a difference? And you could argue that it did, because Christianity unites post-Roman Europe culturally. It creates a shared framework of belief. It maintains Latin as a unified elite language for a really long time, so at least educated people can communicate across different boundaries. And that makes it easier to trade, makes it easier for people to move. It makes it easier for ideas to be disseminated across Europe. And that's an important part of the equation. But Christianity then also divides, right? Once you reach the 16th century, it becomes a major source of division, contributing to the all the other divisions out there. So it is arguably a pretty important legacy of Rome. And I'm inclined to suspect maybe the single most important legacy of Rome, or maybe even the only one that really mattered ultimately in terms of long-term development, which as a classicist, I'm not supposed to say because, you know, we always right. promote the lasting significance of the classical heritage in terms of political thought and any number of things. And all these legacies exist, and they are certainly meaningful and important. I just don't think they were as crucial in bringing about modernity as arguably Christianity was.
Yeah, you write, but what would it have taken to erase Christianity and thus probably also high register medieval Latin from post-Roman Europe? In principle, very little. Regardless of what we make of the canonical stories, there can be no doubt that Christianity grew from very small beginnings and might just as well not have done so at all. When in the early 60s CE, one Jesus, son of Ananias, made a nuisance of himself by predicting a judgment against Jerusalem and the sanctuary and against all the people, the local authorities handed him over to the Roman governor, who had him flayed to the bone even after Jesus failed to respond to the governor's queries. The latter chose to dismiss him as a harmless madman. Except for the final outcome, the other elements of this tale closely resemble those attributed to his more famous namesake. I had no idea about that particular story.
I like that story. I would tell it to my students because this guy even had the same name.
Yeah.
The story is essentially the same story, which is really quite striking.
Usually you hear it with the, was it Tibius? No, it was, I think it was Titanius of, I'm messing up the name, but there was a guy also in first century Rome who healed the sick and was raised.
Oh, people do this all the time. I mean, the Middle East at the time is full of people who perform miracles and heal the sick and the dead and all the rest of it. So, it's remarkable that one of them had a career in the afterlife that was so.
Yeah. Well, so it's not Jesus. It's Paul, not just Paul. It's, you know, Constantine, you know, on the bridge, and he has his vision or whatever and decides, okay, we're going to make this the official state religion or whatever. I mean, had that not happened, would Christianity, even with Paul's proselytizing, have spread as it did?
Well, it would have spread more slowly. The question is whether it could have withstood Islam. Of course, then you have to ask, would there have been Islam without the success of Christianity first, given that Islam itself is influenced by Judaism and Christianity? There's a huge knock-on effect historically. And that's what makes counterfactuals so tricky, right? You change one bit, and then if you want to predict how this affects developments hundreds of years later, you're really all out at sea. You just can't. And that's why controlled counterfactuals are the best way to go. And that's what I try to promote in the book, because historians often say, just study what really happened. Don't worry about what didn't happen. But again, I say you can't really understand causality without considering counterfactuals. When I say A is important for B, then I already implicitly say, well, C wasn't as important for B, right? I mean, there is always counterfactual reasoning involved in much of what we do. And I think we have to bring it out into the open and make it part of the historical mainstream.
Would Islam be even bigger without Christianity, or would it just a different history?
If Islam had developed, not without, but alongside a weaker Christianity in Europe, I'm sure Europe could easily have been converted with or without military conquest in the course of the Middle Ages. Islam made major inroads in Africa, for instance, not always necessarily coupled to conquest, all the way into Indonesia. It was a very attractive and a belief system, and it could very easily have succeeded in Europe as well.
Yeah. Dinesh D'Souza, the conservative commentator, wrote a book called What's So Great About Christianity? Not a question mark, just what's so great about it. And, you know, he cherry picks, of course, his examples where Christian nations develop capitalism and civil rights and civil liberties and so on. Well, what about all the countries that were Christian, like South American countries or Eastern Orthodox countries, that were Christian, believed in Jesus and so on, read the Bible and whatnot, and did not develop capitalism and civil rights and so forth.
Anytime anyone proposes a single cause to explain something, you should run for cover. Because it's exceedingly unlikely that this is true. It may well be an ingredient, it may be an important factor, but single cause theories just don't cut it. That's why my book is so big, right? If it was that simple, it's just saying, I found the one thing, and we'll just take it from there. And I try to be as parsimonious as possible, cut it down to the true essentials, and there are three instead of one. But, you know, you can't really go much further than this. The real world is infinitely complex. We can simplify it. We must simplify it to understand it, but only up to a point.
Right. Well, that's Occam's razor. It's not just cut it down to one. It's just the minimum number you need without overdoing it. I mean, your final page here, plate tectonics, warriors, and perhaps preachers interacted in very specific ways to create the environment that gave birth to modernity. But where does all this leave the Romans? What did they ever do for us before the empire fell apart? What seems to me the most honest answer is also disappointingly vague, that they quite possibly may have done something very important for us if, but only if, their empire, by turning to Christianity, laid some crucial foundations for much later development, but that they just as likely may not have contributed anything essential at all to this eventual outcome, and thus failed to shape the general appearance, if not some of the finer points, of the world we live in today. Final thoughts on this.
Well, the finer details are, you know, that we have classical architecture in Washington, D.C., right? Okay. That's the icing on the cake.
Right.
But, you know, our political institutions come out of medieval England and owe nothing to Roman political thought. People always go on about the founding fathers reading the Roman classics.
Yeah.
And they did. They are influenced by this. But they live in a world that is shaped by other things that are independent of the Roman legacy. So we have to be very careful in how we weigh these different factors.
Well, your book is an impressive piece of research. I believe you have graduate students and teams of people and lots of other people that you work with, right?
It was sadly just me in this case.
Oh, it was? Yeah, well, you put some serious time in that. What's next?
I had thought about this for a long time, so I had to just write it all down. Yeah. It had been in my head for a long time, and you write it all down. Now I'm taking a little bit of a break because I did The Great Leveler. I did this, two big books in the last 4 years, and now I'm really trying to reorient and reinvent myself. But I will definitely let you know when I figure that out.
Yeah, we'll have you on for the next book. No, it's great stuff. I love having that kind of big historical perspective on things. That itself is kind of a new field that I've loved watch growing, big history. And the last two decades, it's really been kind of introduced to the general public that all these big factors matter in terms of how the modern world turned out. And again, you can't just attribute it to a single factor. So congratulations on helping bring all that to us.
Thank you.
And thanks for coming on the show. Again, the book is Escape from Rome. By the way, I love the cover. It's a great cover. Good, nice montage of the modern world and the fallen Roman statue there.
Did you get the reference to Escape from New York?
Yes, of course. Yeah, yes. I got that. Yeah, yeah,
you have
to
be of a certain generation,
yeah. No, I got that. The Failure of Empire and the Road to Prosperity. Walter Scheidel, thank you so much for coming on the show. Congratulations on the book.
Thanks. Always a pleasure.
We'll talk to you next time.